part of my job here is to try to sum up everything and tell us which way to go. I will do neither, but I will try to tie together some of the threads that have come through this discussion and also from earlier this morning, and try to at least lay out some questions and directions for our way forward if it's not really the way. I think Georgi set this off correctly by posing the fundamental question that we're facing currently in public opinion research and frankly in democracy is the question of trust. Trust is necessary for legitimacy, legitimate exchange of information between people. It's a certain kind of trust is required for democracy to function. People may not like the results, but they trust that there's an institution that is reflecting their views and they were able to participate in it. And when that trust is gone, when it's absent, that damages everybody. It makes it very difficult to have democracy and to have self-governance. So, I'll have to take the flipper. I'm on here somewhere. So I would argue, and I think all the colleagues here would agree, that public opinion research is fundamental to that, and that what we're doing here, therefore, today is very, very important. So what is public, just to come full circle about what it is we're talking about, public opinion research is, the goal of it is to understand what people think and believe, and it's predicated on the principle that there is something that people think and believe, that those opinions are real, that they can be measured, and that they matter. And all of those are all essentials. And it is possible, of course, if one has an interest in doing so, to question all of those things. Yeah, are they really, now maybe the opinions aren't real, they change all the time and it doesn't, what's the difference? Or maybe they can't really be measured, or the way you're using to measure it doesn't work, and therefore there's no point, or that it doesn't really matter what people think. There are people who have an interest in undermining those principles. But if we believe in those principles, those are sort of underpin the idea that we have then democracy, and that is the idea that people can make choices for themselves about how they are governed. So public opinion research is a critical part of this. It's a critical part of making democracy work. It obviously provides guidance to candidates for office, but also people who advocate. We haven't talked as much about the structures of civil society outside of government today that I would say most of our clients are from, even though we do work for candidates and we are a partisan pollster in the United States. Nevertheless, we give, what we think is objective observations to those partisan clients, because without it, they would be getting erroneous information and be making bad decisions. But we're, we proudly admit that we do that. We also work for, though, many nonpartisan actors and people outside of the structures of government, and those are essential, to a functioning, a thriving democracy, as you have different kinds of interests, different kinds of advocates participating in the system to try to move agendas forward. And opinion research can be incredibly important to all of those kinds of organizations and to that, because again, having information about what people think and what they believe and how they respond to different arguments helps shape effective advocacy, and that's really important. And then, of course, to hold government itself accountable. I mentioned, this morning that it matters whether or not, to use a U.S. example, whether or not President Trump does he have 40% approval rating for his policies? Does he have a 60% or an 80% approval rating? Well, he has objectively, looking across all of the data, currently about a 40% approval rating. And even if that's off by a few points, it matters. And it's fundamentally different in terms of what he can and should be able to proceed with in terms of policy, whether he has that support or not. So the power and meaning of opinion research depends on, and some of these points have come up with this panel already. It first of all requires that there be real political competition. And we do work, of course, not only in the US, but all over the world, and most, you know, in the last few years, and several here in Georgia and other states in Eastern Europe and the post-Soviet states and emerging democracies, which have different kinds of challenges in terms of effective research, including we just completed research in Belarus. They had elections in Belarus a few months ago. They were not particularly free and fair. There's, you know, there are many levels of having an emerging democracy. Nevertheless, it was still useful to find out what people were thinking and to use that data to inform, in this case, mostly opposition parties who were trying to create political space. So still valuable, even in a less competitive political environment and what is more of a non-competitive politics like you have in Belarus, or a, you know, more competitive, certainly more open democracy as here in Georgia. But having some kind of competition is important because it makes government more responsive, more open. And of course, leaders, and this is critical for sort of setting the rules, right? What are we going to say? Are we going to agree that, you know, certain results are respected? Certain changes occur as a result of either how people voted or what the government decides. And if leaders know that they could lose and somebody could vote them out and somebody else could come in, that provides them an incentive to actually listen to the people and follow the rules. So that political competition is critical for the accountability that's necessary in a democracy. So again, just the importance of public opinion research in that. Also critical though, of course, and Nino pointed this out, is the necessity of having independent media, and you know, there's an issue we're facing around the world, and this has been, you know, it's not new that there are media sources that are biased and have agendas. That's always been true. There's been propaganda for as long as there has been politics, but nevertheless, if you have enough financially independent and politically independent media competing with each other, who can both hold not only politicians accountable, but hold researchers accountable, ask legitimate questions about the quality of the research and what it finds, and demand transparency, that allows, again, for a more robust, a real discourse, as opposed to simply a situation of pure competition where people just pick their own sources, believe those, disbelieve everything else, and there's no shared, there's no dialogue about what the facts are or what the research shows. So that the independent media is critical, and then of course the transparency of the researchers. And we've talked quite a bit today about the importance of those of us who do the research being transparent about what we're doing, how we're doing it, what the flaws and weaknesses are, what the uncertain level of uncertainty is. Aaron mentioned the need to represent what our uncertainty is, not to just say, here's the number, that's the truth, when we know that isn't the case. But to say this number corresponds to something that is the truth, and here's the level of uncertainty we have about it, that's a more accurate way to say it. But that's very different from saying, well, it's not 100% certain, so who knows, none of it matters. That's a poor conclusion, and it makes it very difficult to have any kind of a real democracy if we're sort of abandoning any effort to recognize, yes, there's a truth that's out there, we're measuring it as best we can, and here are the flaws or here are the potential weaknesses in our ability to do that. But frankly, we are facing, I think, a higher level of, I think it's more difficult, certainly. And again, it's hard to be in a state where there used to be, you know, totalitarian control of media and other things in you know, within living memory, and say things are better. It is better in a state like Georgia, where you have more competition and more different kinds of information sources than were available 20, 30 years ago. I would say in my country, we're experiencing a recognition that we have more difficulty in reaching a sort of the ability to understand and share a certain set of facts about the world and a degree of objectivity about the information we're receiving. And we've entered this era. Some people in the U.S. U.S. and other parts of Western Europe have talked about the post-factual politics of the era of fake news. And this is a real phenomenon, and it is under, I think it's a real problem that it's undercutting the what used to be, at least across people who had access to independent sources of information, a shared perception of reality. And as I said, propaganda is not new. It's always been around. But the degree to which, even in the countries with, you know, very free media and many sources of information, there is a great increase in the amount of sort of high volume, multi-channel, rapid, continuous, repetitive propaganda from various sources that no longer finds a need to try to tell a consistent story, but in fact has the aim of undercutting the very belief that there could be an objective set of facts, something that we can agree to and then make decisions about together. That poses a pretty serious problem for democracy, and we're one that we're facing, we're staring in the face right now in the West, as well as around the world. In addition to those broader big problems, challenges that we have in terms of objectivity and being able to assess the truth of information, we have some very specific problems, and many of these have come up earlier in the day, for public opinion research itself. This question of trust, the belief that many people have that researchers are somehow the tools of specific interests or parties, and we are, well, there's a tension, of course, right, because we wish to be above board and honest about what we do. We need to offer up and share the potential flaws, the uncertainty that's built into the research we do. But we're in an environment where when you are disclosing that uncertainty and being honest and upfront about that, if somebody has found it and decides in their interest that they want to attack and undermine your data and say you're a tool of some interest and this can't be trusted and it's wrong, your very admission of flaws and uncertainty is used against you, right? It is used to undermine the very possibility that there could be objective information. And that's not what you're admitting at all, but of course that it's how it's used. And that, again, poses a real challenge for opinion research. There are also some very practical challenges. It's as noted, you know, research interviews still require people's willingness to tell a stranger their honest opinions. We've talked about some of the inherent problems with that and some of the current challenges we have with it, particularly the declining response rates. And someone mentioned there was a survey here in Georgia, and they had only a 70% response rate, and people were attacking that and saying, therefore, there's all this social desirability bias. I haven't seen a 70% response rate in research in the U.S. in 25 years. It's we get, you know, really good, well-run, well-designed professional survey research is getting 15 to 20% response rates when we can in the U.S., and that's good. And we found ways to compensate for that continually declining response rate to continue to have what appears to be pretty accurate results, but honestly, the continuation of that decline is going to pose an increasing challenge. We can use some of the techniques Aaron mentioned in terms of randomized response, multiple imputation models. I mean, there's a lot of useful new tools that will allow us, I think, to again overcome or compensate for these greater challenges and difficulties in getting people what used to be the pretty simple model of survey research, which is ask people questions and write down what they told you. We still are essentially doing that, but we're hopefully managing our samples and managing our data in such a way so that we can understand the biases and control for those. And then, of course, there are actors, and I would just, you know, frankly, there's a movement toward authoritarianism around the world and strengthening in the West that wants to exploit these weaknesses and these real weaknesses that exist in our democratic systems, but particularly in opinion research, to undermine the very idea of accurate opinion research and to advance their own interests. And of course, I just gave a couple of quotes from our president, who has engaged pretty directly in this behavior. I would pose that that's a really serious threat to have someone with that kind of power actively seeking to undermine the very idea that you can have accurate poll results. Let me just wrap up if I can get the thing. There we go. We talked a little, on the first panel, we talked some about the misses and the problems and the difficulties of opinion research. Again, in two of the countries that have the most advanced, high quality, effective polling in the world, in the UK and the United States. There were two, you know, big high-profile misses or perceived to be misses. We talked about how that's the degree to which those were wrong have been somewhat exaggerated, but this is this. You can't really read all the details of this table, but the point of it is, yes, there was something a little something off in the way we were measuring opinion in the U.S. state by state, even though the national numbers were in the end pretty accurate. Several of the key states we were off, all in the same direction. That's a real problem. It is something we're continuing to analyze to understand how to account for the difficulties that we had, and those. Those are real difficulties, and of course they shake confidence in the whole idea of opinion research, but we certainly can't put our heads in the sand and pretend that there's no problem. We have to then address and continue to try to improve what we're doing to you know, recognize and create mechanisms that we can correct and be more accurate as we go forward. So what are some of the paths forward? Well, the best pollsters are those, I think, who are taking their job seriously and recognizing this whole set of very serious challenges that I just mentioned, are innovating technologically. They are improving the ability to reach people through, you know, mobile technology. People are living their lives with these mobile devices to get more complete samples. There are ways of reaching more and more people through online and phone samples than we have ever had before. To make sure that those samples are accurate, complete, and comprehensive, it does require a serious investment. It requires, you know, an effort. It requires quality sampling. It requires professional interviewing through whatever mode you're doing it. And it requires people to sponsor and pay for that innovation and that accuracy. And as I said, there's certainly a role for partisan parties and candidates. They need this information, and it's absolutely fine for them to be sponsoring and participating in this as long as it's transparent and we know who's paying for it and why. Because in the end, if they're going to need accurate information in order to be successful in persuading the public. So we should welcome their participation in opinion research. But of course, we should have nonpartisan actors as well who have the resources and are willing to step up and sponsor the quality that's needed in terms of sampling and accuracy. As I mentioned this morning, I think one of the real challenges we have, and it's under-reported or under-recognized, is the ability to project who will actually turn out and vote in elections to the degree to which polling is looking at elections. And of course, there's other uses for, you know, there are different samples that if you just want to know about the whole public and it's simpler. I mean, there's still many challenges in sampling, but at least you know you want to get everyone. But when you're talking about an election, you don't want everyone. You want the people who are going to vote, and you have to have a really clear projection of who that is. And we're getting better, I would say modestly better at that, but we have a long way to go to really understand in advance, projecting forward into the future, who is going to turn out and who isn't in some future election that's maybe about some new set of parties or candidates that didn't exist before, or a new issue like Brexit. And really, really knowing who is going to vote and who isn't, and that's critically important to having an accurate, accurate research, accurate results. And then there's a whole new set of tools becoming available through, you know, the aggregation of data that's available on people. There are certainly, you know, privacy issues and concerns that I share about how much data is available on everyone in this room and to whom. But it is available, and because of that. There's certainly things we want to be doing as researchers to take advantage of that, so that just to improve again the accuracy, and it make you know there are ways to begin to find opinion or measure opinion that maybe rely less on an interviewer asking someone a question and trusting that they will answer it honestly, because people are sharing their opinions about things in lots of other ways that are certainly. Theoretically and increasingly are practically measurable, and you know we're doing this is a very crude, simple, just a word cloud that was generated about all the tweets about immigration in a particular week in the American election campaign. But you know this is part of a larger social media assessment we did using the you know pretty simple social media tools. But as we increase in sophistication, we can begin to then. Break down and assess and understand better what those social media data are telling us, and use that in much the way that we use random sample surveys today. And then I think Hans pointed out another thing that is a path forward, which is to try to describe our results in ways that go beyond the traditional, here's a horse race, here are the numbers, and claiming that that's accurate and that's what it is, when in fact we can describe our findings in a way that create the sense of a corridor of expectation where it's no longer simply this number and that number, but finding ways to get the public to understand that we're talking about a range of possibilities and how likely those possibilities are. Not that all possibilities are equally likely, that's not the case. The point of doing the research is to see what's more likely and what's less likely, but to recognize, of course, that those data need to be presented as possibilities and probabilities, not as certainties. So those are some of the ways forward, but obviously there's plenty to do and plenty to learn about doing it, exactly how we do it and exactly what steps we need to take. So I'll stop and happy to take questions. Thank you.